There are costs, and we have to take those into account as we try to work within an international framework to do everything we can to see Assad ousted, somebody who's lost credibility, and to try to restore a sense of a democratic process and stability inside of Egypt.
I don't know where to start. If you actually deconstruct that statement, it's wrong on so many levels. And however, we often have people from Breitbart on the show, and they're in Los Angeles or other parts of the United States. But the editor-in-chief, Joel Pollack, is actually with us today in studio. But for a very strange reason, he's on holiday, he's on vacation, and he's in Toronto.
Yes.
Whatever. I mean,
beautiful city. I'm enjoying it.
It is.
Fantastic.
Now, let's speak about your president. And I mean, he's a man of obvious abilities and charisma. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to foreign policy, and it's not just that I object to a more liberal foreign policy, he seems to be out of his depth. He doesn't seem to understand the reality, for example, of the Middle East.
I don't think he's interested in the reality of the Middle East. I think he's interested in a projection of what that reality is or was. I think he came to office believing that everything Bush had done was absolutely wrong, that American leadership itself was somehow morally wrong and politically backwards. So he then reversed many of Bush's policies. For example, in Syria, where Obama and before him many other Democrats, when they came to power in the congressional elections of 2006, 2007, they tried to rehabilitate the Syrian regime. Mm. Obama reopened the U.S. embassy, sent an ambassador, and Hillary Clinton, then Secretary of State, was talking about how Assad was a reformer and so on. They tried the same thing in Egypt with Hosni Mubarak, where Obama cut funds, actually, to democratic groups and was coddling Mubarak. He did give a speech about the Muslim world and its relations with the United States in Egypt, and he invited the Muslim Brotherhood to that speech, but that wasn't because he was interested in seeing the Muslim Brotherhood participate in a democratic process. It's because of his broader outreach to the Muslim world. Mm-hmm. His idea was that by, in a sense, having a rapprochement with the Islamic world in general, and by backing away from the democracy agenda in particular, that he could establish stability and better relations than had been the case under George Bush. We've seen that all fall to pieces. We have seen the Syria policy fall apart completely, where not only have we had to draw our ambassador out, but now we're talking about military strikes in defiance of the UN, by the way. The Obama administration said it didn't want to or need to have UN inspectors go to look at the chemical weapons sites to see if there had actually been attacks on civilians, as alleged. So now Obama's done a complete reversal of his formerly anti-Bush policies. Now he is in open defiance of the United Nations, prepared to go to war without UN Security Council approval. It's the UK that's introducing the resolution, not the United States. Mm. And it's all confused. The only consistent theme is that President Obama believes in leading from behind. He's let things go this long because he doesn't believe in American leadership. 100,000 civilians later, he finally decides to do something. Mm. Several months after initial allegations of the use of chemical weapons, he finally decides to do something. So, yes, he's out of his depth because he subscribes to a view of American foreign policy that is really only credible in the faculty lounges of elite universities and nowhere else.
UN, I think this is directly pertinent because, look, Russia and China would always veto. They were never going to get Security Council backing. But the weapons inspectors have said, just give us a few more days, wait till maybe Monday or Tuesday. And even that now seems to be rejected. The general view is, but by Friday evening, there'll be some sort of military intervention.
Obama's chief concern is not to oust the Assad regime, as he said in that clip, because if he had wanted to do that, he would have done it long ago. His chief concern is not to stop the civil war. His chief concern is to be seen to be doing something that seems remotely effective. And to do that, he doesn't need UN Security Council approval in his own mind. He just needs to do something so that he can then say, well, we've done what we needed to do to establish a deterrent to the use of chemical weapons in future. He's not concerned about civilians, he's not concerned about human rights. I'm just being very blunt here, because if he had been concerned about those things, he would have acted differently and acted far sooner. Obama's goal is not really to achieve any resolution. Perhaps he wants to see Assad go, but he's also doubtful about that. He would have assisted the rebels or the anti-Assad forces much earlier if he really wanted to get Assad out. Now it's much more difficult with Iran fighting for the Assad regime, with Russia supplying the Assad regime, and so on. And by the way, that's an aspect I don't think anyone is considering. The fact that Iran is basically the other side of this war, not the Assad regime, which is essentially a shell at this stage. No one is thinking, neither the Obama administration nor the pundits, both left and right, who are urging now that we respond to this, no one's thinking about the consequences for potential conflict with Iran. I, for one, believe we should be prepared for conflict with Iran, because that's actually the real source of the conflict that's ongoing in Syria. It's the source of major foreign policy challenge to the Western world. But we're not prepared to do that. Obama doesn't want to do that. He's busy trying to plead for talks with the new supposedly reformist president of Iran. So he's not prepared to actually pose a challenge to Iran. So what Iran gets out of this is they get the United States drawn into a conflict. It's a distraction. Meanwhile, they continue building centrifuges, continue enriching uranium, continue working towards a nuclear weapon. And we're tied up in all of this. The American public is overwhelmingly against any sort of military intervention in Syria. Only 9% of the American people support this. If you tell them that chemical weapons have been used, it only goes up to 25%. I mean, this is a war overwhelmingly opposed by the American people. And it doesn't mean you have to pay attention to the polls. I mean, if you're president, you have to lead. But lead to where? Lead for what? He's just led from behind the entire way. Now he's inherited from himself a situation that's in shambles. And what really is needed is a complete rethinking of U.S. foreign policy. Obama needs to understand Iran as the enemy, and we need to think, with everything we do in Syria, in Lebanon, in Egypt even, how does this advance our interests in the conflict with Iran, which is a conflict? That's how they see it. The Iranian red line is any American intervention directly in the Syrian conflict. They've said, well, you know, you say chemical weapons are a red line, we say your intervention is a red line that amounts to an act of war that we will take as such. I don't know if that threat is a credible one. It could just be bluster, but we are not thinking in those terms yet. We're not thinking about what is in the long-term best interest of the United States and the region. And that clearly is an Iran without a nuclear weapon and probably without the regime that currently rules the country, which is deeply unpopular. We could have perhaps pushed it over in 2009 during the Green Revolution, but Obama waited 11 days even to say anything about that. So his agenda, built on this ideology, which was just a political construct to oppose George W. Bush, has completely fallen apart. Then he falls in with leading from behind, you know, letting Europe take the lead, France, Britain, and so forth. He's doing it again here. Yep. And it's not an agenda forward. It's actually going to place the United States in greater danger, because the longer we defer and delay facing up to the Iranian challenge, whether militarily or diplomatically, the more deadly, the more dangerous this conflict is eventually going to become.
Mm. I've learned many things. I've also learned we should have given you two segments because I asked two questions, and that was extraordinary. We've got to get you back. Thank you so very much indeed.
Great to be here.